center rail, which is how the locomotive and cars climb and descend the railway. And so halfway down, they're going to take a little bump or something. Piece is missing. As Stan mentioned, we've known each other for something like 30 years, and our mutual friend John Jakes passed away last winter, and so if I could, I'd like to dedicate tonight's talk to John. I've known Randy Bennett since 1994, when he produced his book, The White Mountains, and it's still the best of the hundreds of books in the series of Images of America published by Arcadia Press. Tonight, as I tell you the story of Sylvester Marsh, so you don't think I just made this all up, I'm going to do quite a bit of quoting from Marsh's writings. On the left, we're looking at a steel engraving of Marsh in his late 70s, a decade after he completed his car railway. And on the right is an article and illustration published 2 years before he built it. A group of city dandies is being carried up the mountain on Marsh's device, and some local mountaineers are looking at them as though they were invading aliens coming in on a UFO. When Marsh died in 1884, he left his wife, Cornelia, and four daughters. Let's see if I know my buttons. No, I don't. He left Cornelia, my great-grandmother, and his four daughters. The youngest of the four on the right is his daughter, Harriet. He called her Hattie, and she was my grandmother. Here she is, 60 years later, surrounded by her grandchildren. The one in her lap who won't sit up is me. Sylvester Marsh was the ninth of 11 children. He was born in 1803 and grew up on his family farm in the foothill town of Campton, New Hampshire. The world he was born into was nearer that of ancient Roman Greece than to ours, and that's because he was born and his life spanned the Industrial Revolution, and his work, especially the railway, reflected it. On the left is Asher Duran's 19th century painting, View of Campton Valley. The Pemigewasset River divides the town in two, and in the distance we see Mount Lafayette and Franconia Notch. This was almost the same view that Marsh had when he climbed the hill behind his family's house. On the right is a photograph, probably from the 1870s, of the village of Campton, looking over in the direction of the Marsh farm, which was just beyond this hill. Mount Lafayette would play plays a very important role in his later life. Marsh described growing up in Campton, and I suspect it was much like growing up in Bethel at the time. I'm going to hold these two images on the screen while I read you some of his recollections. He wrote, quote, "Where I lived, there were all farmers. The country was good for potatoes and for winter grain. Winter rye and winter wheat did very well. It was poor country for corn. We all had orchards. The first thing a farmer did when he cleared the upland was to set out trees, and all took apples to the mill in the fall and made cider to last the year round," unquote. About schooling, he wrote, quote, "We got 3 months schooling in the winter. No summer school. I had to go 2 miles to school. The schoolhouse was about 24 feet square, all in one room with one big fireplace and wooden benches. We had arithmetic, geography, and the first rudiments of grammar, reading, writing, spelling, and oratorical speaking. The school had, I think, 25 boys and 15 girls. That's 40 scholars. Teachers got about $8 a month in board, and they boarded around with different families," unquote. When Marsh was growing up in Campton, 1803 to 1823, there were no bridges across that Pemigewasset. They had to ford or take the ferry across the river, and the Marsh family went to the seats that lifted up when you stood up at prayers, making that much more room. When the preacher said amen and the folks sat down again, the clapping of the seats was astonishing. There was no heating of the church, no fire anywhere near it. The women used to bring small boxes of sheet iron in wooden frames with holes inside so that they could keep their feet warm. Every woman almost brought such a thing. The sermon was always at least an hour long. They were never short of that. And the prayers were pretty long. There was no Sabbath school. We call it Sunday school. The children went to church with the parents. We had a tithing man with a long pole to keep order. And when the boys made too much noise, they got rapped on the head. We paid the minister $400 a year, paid him in produce and in wood. No cash at all, but in such material as he could live on. There was scarcely any money in the countryside at the time. Business was done by dicka, that is by bargain. Our principal exports, that would be cash crops, our principal exports were potash and clover seed. In clearing our land, we rolled the logs together and saved the ashes, put up our leeches, gut lye, and boiled it down. The farmers used to go down once a year in sleighing time to the seaport towns, either Boston or Portland, with whatever farm products they had for sale, and they always loaded back with rum. That was the first thing always. And tobacco, salt, saltfish. Then they got some tea and coffee if there was any money left after they got the other things. Rum was just as common a drink as water. There was no building raise, nor funeral that occurred, nor anything else hardly without rum. A person would not consider himself gently used on going into a house without being asked to take a drink, unquote. Certainly the hardest year was 1816, popularly called 1800 and froze to death. Said Marsh, quote, in 1816 there was frost every month of the year. No corn was raised. We lived during that year mostly on potatoes and milk, unquote. Crops withered, orchards were barren, and there was starvation in the counties around here. Quote, that was the bluest time that we'd ever seen. In 1817, the crops were fair, and the country began to prosper again, unquote. In 1823, Marsh's mother died. His father gave up the farm and went to live with his oldest son. And so 19-year-old Sylvester Marsh left Hampton, walking the 117 miles to Boston, the commercial capital of New England. If there had been a stage, he couldn't have afforded it. With only farming skills, he first worked and lived on a suburban gentleman's farm of William and Francis Jackson in Newton on the right. The Jackson brothers may have become role models for Marsh, for they were Boston businessmen, devout congregationalists, among the founders of the abolitionist movement, and very involved in the growing technology of the day. A decade later, the Jackson brothers would spearhead building Boston's first steam railroad. It ran from downtown to this very farm, and then went west to Worcester. Later extended, it became the Boston and Albany Railroad. Marsh became intrigued by the technologies he saw developing around him. In 1823, he spent 2 days examining America's first mill city, Lowell, starting to be constructed on the Merrimack River. Mills there were like multi-story machines. Raw wool or cotton entered at one point and was drawn back and forth, up and down through the various processes, finally to emerge from the building as bolts of cloth, everything powered by the natural fall of the river. Lowell Mills became famous as the earliest examples of what would be called the American factory system. But it would be the steam engine, not water, that would power the industrial revolution. In 1831, when the locomotive DeWitt Clinton began hauling cars from Albany to Schenectady, New York, opening the first steam Marsh settled in Ashtabula, Ohio, just off on map here to the left. And there, for the next 5 years, he carried on the provision trade and he began packing meat. In October 1833, Marsh went further west to Chicago. The frontier village had a population of 300 when he arrived, smaller than the captain he had left. When he returned to Boston 25 years later, this is the same view in 1858, over 100,000 people lived in Chicago. His business card shows he continued in both the provision and meatpacking trade, and as a result, he's one of the founders of Chicago meatpacking. In 1848, Chicago's first railroad, the Galena and Chicago Union, later it became the Chicago and Northwestern, was built to the prairies northwest of the city, and it terminated behind Marsh's riverfront property. A Chicago newspaper in 1850 reported the building of a, quote, new establishment of Sylvester Marsh, situated immediately upon the bank of the river. And we can see it here in this model. I think it says, the lead carpenter, successor to S. Marsh, division. I think, although I've seen it rather. The article continued, quote, for the business of packing, it is perhaps the best house in the city. Mr. Marsh expects to slaughter 4,500 cattle during the season. He sells his beef in Boston, at which place his brand is so well known and so highly esteemed as to sell readily at the top of the market without inspection, unquote. The Galena Railroad's first locomotive, Pioneer, delivered corn-fed cattle and pigs directly from the prairie to Marsh's plant. And the three-story plant that the article described is similar to those early mills in Lowell. But here, cattle and hogs enter one door and barrels of beef and pork roll out another. And here, instead of water power as at Lowell, the pulling and hoisting was done by wheels and ropes worked by a steam engine. Meat packing was achieving a new efficiency. As a packer friend of his said, quote, every part of the hog is used except the whistle. In 1844, in his private life, Marsh married Charlotte E. Bates of Monson, Massachusetts. Their two children, John Franklin and Mary, are in this daguerreotype. John Franklin, called Frank, later would play an important role in the Cog Railway. Tragically, in 1850, after the unsuccessful birth of their third child, Marsh's wife died. And in 1855, the widower remarried. Amelia Hoyt had come to Illinois with her parents. She had been born and brought up in St. Albans, Vermont. She was my great-grandmother, and she's holding Sylvester Jr. Historically, Chicago by the 1850s was a hotbed of agricultural invention. This photograph, on which the previous model undoubtedly was based, shows almost adjacent to Marsh's packing plant, which is here, is the plant of Cyrus McCormick, who is just beginning to build and distribute his reapers. And then, if I get the right one, about 100 miles west of Marsh's plant is this Chicago's first high-rise grain elevator, another Midwest invention. But Chicago was becoming the largest grain port in the world. A problem that hindered shipping grain, especially overseas, was its tendency to sour or spoil while in storage or on shipboard. In 1853, a Chicago newspaper reported, quote, our citizen Sylvester Marsh paid much attention to this business of drying corn, and he's just embodied his ideas in a kiln of considerable size. And you can see his kiln here called Marsh's Caloric Grain Bug. The building enclosed an apparatus, a model of which is shown in the drawing. Heated air was forced up through a layer of grain by fans, while a carriage moved continuously back and forth, distributing and stirring and moving the grain. The perforated platform actually is 20 by 40 feet. But Marsh was attempting to dry large BHS shipped meal around Cape Horn to California and stored it there a year. And when it came back, it was just as good as when first ground, unquote. By 1855, Marsh was drying, then milling, and exporting 50,000 barrels a year of Marsh's dried cornmeal. His cornmeal would continue in production for the next 30 years. The Tribune article concluded, quote, "The effect of this discovery upon the demand for our great staple in Europe can scarcely be overestimated. We regard this as one of the most important discoveries of the age, and its enterprising, ingenious inventor will live in history as one of the benefactors of his species." There is a very good example of 19th century hyperbole. It doesn't even need music. In late 1855, Marsh, a workaholic all his life, resolved to retire. He left the operation of his dried cornmeal company in the hands of a young partner. And with his new family, he moved to the Jamaica Plain section of West Roxbury, a leafy suburb just starting to be developed outside of Boston. To keep track of his business, he took offices at Quincy Markets on the right there, now upstairs from where he had set out from 30 years earlier. Within months, the sudden inactivity caused a physical upset, diagnosed as dyspepsia, and Marsh became eager for a new project. A few years earlier, railroads had started to bring tourists to the White Mountains. Oh, is that out of focus? Could you focus it? Randy or something?
Yes.
Let me bang it forward to that. And so the railroad came to Portland, and although I'm looking at sideways, came to Bethel. In 1851, 150 years ago, just as Randy Bennett's exhibit in the front room shows. And then it continued on to Gorham and went on its way to Montreal. A second railroad came up from Boston to Plymouth, and then because of the grades through the Franconia Notch, it had to veer around the Franconia Range to the Connecticut River before it concluded at Littleton. A carriage road had been built partway up Mount Washington. This is Mount Washington. And a carriage road built partway up it. And that later finished. Today, it's the Mount Washington Auto Road. In August 1857, Marsh made a trip to Campton to see his ailing older brother, who subsequently only survived a few weeks. With him, Marsh brought his pastor from Boston. The two men traveled by train from Boston up to Plymouth, and then by stage on to Campton. Covered bridges now cross the Pemigewasset. Local inns were attracting new business from tourists beginning to go to the mountains. Crop fields were giving way to pasture land, and at the old Marsh farm there was a herd of Jersey cattle and a flock of sheep. Now that there was a bridge, the east and west Hampton congregations had combined and were building this new church, and during the visit, Marsh donated the bell that hangs in its steeple. After their visit, and probably as recompense, Marsh took the Reverend for a brief tramp in the nearby mountains. They traveled from Campton up through Franconia Notch. They stayed at the Profile House. They climbed Mount Lafayette, probably on horseback, and then they went over through Bethlehem, stopped at the White Mountain House, passed the burnt-out Fabian House, and came to Crawford House, where they checked in one Saturday afternoon. On an afternoon that began clear, the two men hiked up the Crawford Path on Mount Washington. Today, the Mount Washington Observatory advises that the summit can have, in their words, the worst weather in the world. But in the 19th century, tourists were not forewarned. Above tree line, the two men were overtaken by a terrific storm. Hurricane winds, freezing rain, a sincere and safer method of ascension, unquote. Marsh considered several different concepts, but there is no evidence he ever considered this one. This is the proposal of a Dr. Joseph Fontaine, who wrote, quote, Mount Washington might be ascended swiftly and comfortably with the aid of my railroad, unquote. However, this ingenious scheme never lifted off the drawing board. Marsh described several of the alternatives he did explore. First, he considered building a funicula, that is, a cable-hauled railway. It was, he said, the usual way of overcoming steep grades for short distances. The first funicula railway in America, built especially for tourists, had opened just the year before in Massachusetts at Mount Holyoke. Tourists arrived there on a mainline railroad, and then, in a car, pulled by a rope worked by a stationary steam engine, they were hauled up to a hotel on the summit that overlooked the oxbow of the Connecticut River. Mount Holyoke, at 1/10 Mount Washington's height, was the precedent and model for Marsh's project. The highest funicular railway in the country, at Portage, Pennsylvania, midway between Philadelphia and Pittsburgh, crossed the Allegheny Mountains in a series of 10 switchbacks or zigzag lines. Marsh considered switchback layouts for Mount Washington. Cars would be pulled up by a series of cables worked by stationary steam engines. But soon he realized, quote, chains of such length as I needed could not sustain their own weight, much less pull up a car of passengers. And there was no means of getting the engine into place, unquote. He concluded he needed an engine that could propel itself up the mountain. In other words, a mountain climbing locomotive. By trial and error, he developed variations of cog locomotive and track systems, working them out in model form. Marsh didn't invent the concept of a cogwheel railway. He was the inventor of the first mountain climbing cog railway in the world. He said to an interviewer, quote, the appliance of cogs to a railway track is by no means a new idea. The very first railroad built in England having used them. Marsh was referring to this level railroad developed by John Bleckensop of Leeds. The earliest railroad inventors expected that even on level grade, round wheels would merely slip or spin in place. To solve that problem, in 1812, Bleckensop patented and had built this locomotive that used an outside cog wheel in which engaged nuts on the side of the rail to propel itself. Bleckensop's railroad was the first commercially successful steam railroad in the world. But within 2 years, it was realized that the friction of round wheels on smooth rails was sufficient to propel an engine on level grade. Although Bleckensop's cog device became irrelevant to railroad designers, it was illustrated in many mid-19th century engineering textbooks. An early scheme Marsh developed called for a locomotive propelled by a pair of cog wheels that gripped two outside rails. Soon he realized it was, quote, impractical as every mechanic will see, he must necessarily go in a straight line, unquote. A railroad running in a straight line up the side of Mount Washington was, of course, inconceivable. Marsh concluded his locomotive must be able to turn curves so the road might better conform to the mountain contours. His final design is shown in his patent drawing on the left. It shows a locomotive climbing a 50% grade. A central cog wheel grips a toothed central rail. Two pairs of other wheels only support and guide the engine. Marsh called for a light locomotive to be substantially geared down to obtain the power needed. Speed would be sacrificed for power. His original patent model on the right was submitted with the drawing in July 1858, 1 month letting him fool away his own money, the state granted him a 5-year charter to build such railways on Mount Washington and Mount Lafayette. But there was an interruption. This was Marsh's Chicago headquarters, and I think he might be up, I don't know if you can read it. This is Marsh's caloric brain. In 1859, unexpected business demands in the Chicago lawsuit prevented further work on the New Hampshire project, and Marsh moved back to Chicago. Since his retirement, grain production from America's heartland had continued to soar, and in the 4 years of his so-called retirement, 300,000 barrels of Marsh's dried cornmeal had been exported. Marsh now returned to Chicago to double that output. He also had devised a vertical automated grain drive, illustrated on the left illustration in that article, that could drive 30,000 bushels of grain a day. And he now erected 7 new dryers, like this one, built in Buffalo, New York on the right. And others of these dryers were located in Brooklyn, another one in Chicago, and 4 more in rural Illinois. Marsh had produced the first successful large-scale grain dryer in the country. Today, Chicago Associates, with some of their money, founded the University of Chicago hospitals and orphanages. Marsh put some of his means in the last 20 years of his life into his home region. When he had left Hampton, the farms of this area were almost impoverished. When he returned, tourism was well underway, but for every one who came to the White Mountains, 20 went to Saratoga. But by the end of the century, local inns and these grand hotels accommodated over 14,000 guests at any one time. His third motive, I believe, was that this could be a family project. Oldest son Frank, on the left, to his father's delight, was following in his footsteps, becoming an inventor, a mechanic, as they called him. He studied engineering at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. Sylvester Jr., on the right, 10 years younger, would read for the law. Between 1863 and 1865, Marsh bought more than 16,000 acres of land, the light colored area, in the lower Amanoosic Valley. And that's about 25 square miles. He bought the White Mountain House. To get our bearings, here is Mount Washington. His land stretched from White Mountain House to just north of Crawford House, from the west side of now Route 302 up to the base of the mountain. And just at this location, where the Amanoosic River flowed onto his property, he located the base station, first called Marshville, now called Marshfield. Then with his son, who studied surveying, they laid out a new entry road 6 miles along the north side of the river up to the base station. And then they mapped out a 3 mile route following the old Fabian bridle trail up to the summit of the mountain. The railway right of way would be acquired by eminent domain, the main feature of the state charter. A major hurdle still remained. The base station would be remote, deep in a forest 26 miles from the end of the nearest mainline railroad to Boston, Concord, and Montreal, and Littleton. Littleton's in the foreground here on the left, Mount Washington in the distance. To make the railway feasible, at least 100 riders were needed every day. How would he get them there? Where would they stay? To Marsh, the answers were obvious. Extend the BCNM to the car and build a big hotel nearby. He told a reporter, quote, "Soon passengers will take railroad cars in New York, check their baggage to the Tip Top House, and with only one change of trains, see the sun rise in Gotham one day and from the top of Mount Washington the next." Unquote. It's pretty crazy. The writer added, quote, "Mr. Marsh proposes as soon as a railway is completed, he proposes the erection of a large hotel." Unquote. To make this happen, Marsh had to convince BCNM President John E. Lyon on the right and their general manager, Joseph A. Dodge. He wrote them describing his vision. The Lyon was quoted as calling the letter as being written by, quote, "some crazy man," unquote. To convince doubters, Marsh had this working model built, and in his Boston office, he installed a 20-foot-long track at a 35% grade. When Marsh fired it up, this little 17-pound locomotive chucked up the track, pushing the car loaded with a 50-pound weight from one floor to a room on the floor above. His proposal was still greeted with skepticism, but reluctantly, Lyon and Dodge agreed. If Marsh, at his own risk, demonstrated on the mountain that his invention worked, they would extend their line and invest in his enterprise. Investing would ensure their commitment. They probably believed that that would be the end of that. It would lead to Marsh's greatest success and his greatest disappointment. In 1865, the Marsh family moved demonstration in August 29, 1866, almost exactly 135 years ago. Visiting railroad executive engineers and reporters were pushed up and lowered down the first 660 feet of track several times. After pushing a carload of men to the top of the track here on the left, Pepper Sass has returned to the base, and the car now demonstrating the safety of its air brake as the men cling to anything they can get hold of. And then watching this scene, standing here is Sylvester Marsh, and here is one of the Kilbourne brothers with his stereo optical camera recording. The Boston Journal said, quote, "The engine works to a charm. Not even the pokers and doubters hesitated a moment to get on either the car or engine and make the trip," unquote. Afterward, everyone poses. Sylvester Marsh is standing here. Further to the right, his head bowed, John Lyon. And if we get another half hour, I'll take this away. By 1 year later, August 1867, Marsh had constructed 1 mile of the trestle roadway. 2 more miles were needed within a year, however, to meet the deadline of the state charter. To meet that schedule, it was agreed that the BC&M should take charge of completing the road. To speed construction, the BC&M's Joseph Dodge contracted with the Aiken Machine Shop of Franklin, New Hampshire, for a second locomotive, almost a replica of the first. The Aiken shop was headed by 36-year-old Walter Aiken, related to Dodge by marriage. On August 14, 1868, after the trestle over Jacob's Ladder was completed, the railway opened for business. It was completed to the summit following July 3, 1869. The Cog Railway and White Mountain tourism flourished, and Sylvester Marsh became celebrated. The Boston Transcript called the first mountain climbing car railway in the world one of the greatest wonders of the time. In 1976, it was designated a National Historic Civil and Mechanical Engineering Landmark. But still in 1869, Marsh's problems weren't over. From what transpired, it's apparent that Lyon and Dodge decided that since the BC&M's future was now tied to this venture, it would be better for their interests if the strong-willed independent inventor were not in charge. Walter Aiken was a businessman, a mechanic, relative, who had the familial loyalty that Lyon and Dodge preferred. The BC&M and Aiken took stock rather than cash for their services, and on that basis, the Aiken shop was commissioned to build 3 passenger engines, like the one on the left, and Aiken became the third largest stockholder. Marsh was now in a minority. Marsh was critical of Aiken's locomotives. Correspondence shows Marsh's advice ignored. He found his improvement to the air brake on the trash pile. His plan for a switch, a sliding platform that would allow up and down trains to pass a useful device on a single track railway, was dismissed and forgotten. Here is Marsh's design built 5 years later in Switzerland. No passing switch was built at Mount Washington until 1941. A distressed Marsh asked to buy back all the stock, but his request was brushed aside. Marsh had expected that, as at Mount Holyoke, the railway would own and benefit from its own Summit Depot Hotel. But over his objections, Walter Aiken was allowed to build and own the new Summit House on the railway's property. In 1870, John W. Dodge was appointed manager of the railway. He was Joseph Dodge's cousin as well as Walter Aiken's father-in-law. There were no openings at Mount Washington for Frank Marsh or Sylvester Jr. Undaunted, Marsh's comments and advice continued. In 1871, he devised and got a caveat to his patent and advised the railway to build a new design locomotive, one with a horizontal boiler, which would be more efficient, with 4 cylinders rather than 2, there's 2 on this side, which would be more powerful, and with power for climbing and braking transmitted to his criticisms private. He wrote, quote, "I feared it would injure the reputation of the road if the public knew I was dissatisfied or had withdrawn from its management," unquote. And he put most of his energies into other projects. In 1873, Marsh sold the White Mountain House, and this time holding the majority of stock, he built Fabian. It was a grand hotel advertised to accommodate 500 guests. In 1874, the DC&M completed their extension from Littleton, Fabian House. And the following year, the Portland-Ogdensburg Railroad reached Fabian House from the east through the Crawford Notch. In 1876, a branch railroad connected Fabian's up to the Cog Railroad, thus providing the rail route from the summit of Mount Washington to all major cities, as Marsh had originally envisioned. 2 months after the Cog Railway was completed, President Ulysses S. Grant came to ride the tardy poses at Longback Tank. And here is Grant, his wife, I can't see it from the same, but it should be two children there, and Marsh is the white-bearded gentleman who come in, posing at Longback Tank. 4 years later, in 1873, President Grant returned to ride the railway and to attend the opening of Fabian House. In July 1877, Marsh hosted a reception at Fabian House for President Rutherford B. Hayes, seen here greeting the guests. The next day, they traveled up the new branch line to the Cog Railway and ascended the mountain together. And 4 years later, July 1881, Marsh again was reported at Fabian House preparing to meet the subsequent President of the United States when news came over the telegraph that James Garfield had been shot in the Washington Railroad Station while boarding his northbound train. A wreath of mourning surrounds his photograph. The only part of Fabian House that remains today is the railroad station, which is now a restaurant. But a century and a quarter ago, Fabian House was at the junction of three railroads and was the center of summer activity on the western side of Mount Washington. Such activity stimulated others to build more hotels nearby. And by 1895, on the site of the present Bretton Woods Motory, the Mount Pleasant House could accommodate 300 guests. And in 1902, the Mount Washington Hotel opened, its grounds encircled by the Cog Railway branch line. Branch line service was suspended in 1932. Fabian House burned in 1951, and the Mount Pleasant House was demolished in 1939. And today, the Mount Washington Hotel is the surviving landmark here of a group of Gilded Age resorts that were built on the line to the Cog Railway. You see the, in this winter scene, you see the base station and the Cog Railway going up to the summit of Mount Washington. We'll change continents right now. This is Switzerland, which we all know is a mountain-filled country in the center of Europe. In April 1867, right after the first demonstration, the Swiss ambassador came to Littleton to meet Marsh and see his experiment. Marsh was happy to share with the Swiss for free drawings, such as the one on the left, and photographs, such as you've been looking at, and advice. Surviving letters show that the Swiss proposed that Marsh share equally with Niklaus Riggenbach in the development of the first European car railway. Marsh declined, but continued his cooperation. The first locomotive of Swiss engineer Riggenbach, quite similar to Marsh's drawing of 1864, was tested at Lake Lucerne's Mount Riki in 1870. Marsh's first engine, on the left, had been dubbed Pepper Sass by locals who thought it looked like a pepper sauce bottle. Similarly, in the Alps, the Swiss Paul Riggenbach's first engine, the Schnapsflasche, such a railway here. Franconia Notch, with Old Man of the Mountain, and here the profile house is now the site of the Cannon Mountain parking lot, could not be reached by conventional rail because of the steep grades. In 1871, 2 years after the completion of the Cog Railway, Marsh returned to the New Hampshire legislature and got a charter to build a railway that would run level from Littleton in the foreground along the valley of Baker Brook and Indian Brook, and then climb up into Franconia Notch. This is Littleton, the Thayer's Hotel. And there is Mount Lafayette with the Franconia Notch beside it. Marsh's proposed railroad would mean increased tourist access to the Notch, and importantly, it would mean Marsh would finally build his proposed Cog Railway on Mount Lafayette. His earlier such charter had expired, and so he got another charter to build a, quote, railway, quote, similar to the one now located and built at the top of Mount Washington, which would run from somewhere, from a point near the profile house at the bottom of that slide on the right, up to the top of Mount Lafayette behind it. You can almost see the route we've taken. While Marsh was getting his charter, Nicholas Riggenbach in 1852 got this patent for the Littleton Franconia locomotive. On level grade, power would go to the outer wheels, here and here. But on slope, power would be transferred to the center cog wheel, which gripped a Marsh cog track. Again, Marsh faced the problem that this Littleton-Franconia Railway needed to connect with the BC&M, and this time he was determined not to lose control. As a result, 5 years passed. But by 1876, the Mount Washington Railway and the BC&M were doing very well. At Mount Washington, a consensus were being replaced by those of Marsh's horizontal design, and John Lyon, with a new respect for Marsh, agreed to be his partner, presumably on Marsh's terms, in both the Franconia and the Mount Lafayette railways. In Switzerland, Riggenbach built the locomotive, but it was too late. Human calamities intervened. In the winter of 1877, both of Marsh's sons, Frank and Sylvester Jr., died within 2 months of each other. From what causes, I don't know, but it was a cruel blow. And in April 1878, John Lyon died in an accident. The locomotive remained in Switzerland, and Marsh gave up his railway plans. In the 100 years following the completion of the Mount Washington Railway, 57 mountain climbing cog railways and 120 dual action, that is the combined adhesion level and cog wheel up and down hill railways, have been built in 35 countries around the world. In America, only 4, and the one on Mount Washington and Pikes Peak are the only 2 that still operate. No dual traction railway has ever been built in this country. But almost universally, these 177 railways follow Swiss designs developed from Marsh's work here. In 1875, following the death of his father-in-law, Walter Aiken became manager of the Mount Washington Railway, and he had become much to identify himself with the railway. In 1877, Aiken wrote his own brief history, Cog Railroads, in the Summit newspaper that his Summit House Hotel sponsored Among the Clouds. Notably, Aiken claimed it was his own father, Herrick Aiken, 30 years earlier, who had first invented and laid out the route of the Mount Washington Railway, but had been talked out of building it. At the time, the claim made little impression. Among the Clouds appears to be the only publication to print Aiken's claim in Marsh's lifetime. But Aiken's claim has baffled every modern White Mountain historian since. Marsh's response can be found in a letter by him now in the Dunton College archives. Marsh wrote, quote, I built the first engine and quite a piece of the road before Mr. Aiken knew anything about it, unquote. Why would Aiken make up such a story? Marsh this may surprise you until you learn that he's always been jealous of my having the reputation for being the originator or inventor of Mount Washington Railroad and its appliances, unquote. Marsh's own concern for recognition, he wrote, quote, "This I care very little about, since I've lost both my sons and shall have no one to reap the advantage I may be entitled to," unquote. Marsh remained president of the Mount Washington Railway, and in 1880, with his wife and four daughters, he moved to Concord, New Hampshire. I'd like to close with just a few comments. Marsh was a lifelong advocate of the benefits of technology. In 1881, near the end of his life, he observed, quote, "A man can live as well now on 4 or 6 hours' work a day as he could on 12 hours' work when I was a boy," unquote. All his life, he'd been a hardworking and inventive capitalist and a socially concerned citizen. A Chicago colleague summed him up with what is my favorite quote. "Put Marsh on a desert island, and in 30 days he will be in business with 3 men working for him, and every man will be wearing a new suit." Unquote. A devout Congregationalist and early abolitionist, in the 1870s, Marsh was on the board of directors of the New Hampshire Woman Suffrage Association. In 1884, pneumonia took him down at 81. His wife and four daughters were at his bedside. The directors of the railway sent his widow this statement. "Resolved that in the recent death of Sylvester Marsh, Esquire, the president of the corporation from its beginning, the board of directors recognized the loss of an associate whose genius and thoughtfulness suggested and originated the enterprise, and whose interest in its